Good afternoon and welcome to the very first Nam Center Colloquium of the year 2017. My name is Youngju Lieu and I teach Korean literature here at the university in the Department of Asian Languages and Cultures. And it is my great and distinct pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Joshua Van Lieu, who comes to us today from LaGrange College in Georgia, where he is assistant professor of history and the curriculum director of Asian studies. Dr. Van Lieu is a historian of early modern and modern East Asian politics, thought, and critical international relations. He received his doctoral degree from the University of Washington, one of the jewels of Korean studies programs in the country, specializing in histories of Joseon Korea and late imperial China. He has served as assistant editor and book review editor for the Journal of Korean Studies and published on 19th century Qing and Joseon tribute politics, the historiography of reform movements in late Joseon Korea, the roles of state Guanti cults in Ming, Qing and Joseon, narratives of state legitimacy, and on critical approaches to historical international relations. His current projects include a paper on the transnational politics of translation in late 19th century Korea and China, and monographs on pre-colonial historiographies of Joseon factionalism, and on the transformation of Qing Joseon tributary practice in the context of the global modern of the long 19th century. As you can tell, these are fascinating topics, and I have been waiting some 2 years to listen to him ever since I encountered, by chance, a very fascinating work he's been doing. And as a description, brief description, probably alerts you to his work as extremely border crossing and particularly exciting for us at this moment for that. And so it's been 2 years of waiting and he's finally here. And so I'm really glad that I have a chance to see myself and to invite you to see in action a very original thinker. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Joshua Van Lieu.
Thank you very much. Thank you to the Nam Center for having me here, and it really is a tremendous honor to be invited, and I've been looking forward to this for a great deal of time. So today I'll be talking on the act was Oriental between Orientals, the persistence of late Victorian translations of the twilight of Qing-Joseon tributary practice. Are you hearing me? Okay, good. I'd like to start off actually with a quotation here. This is a quotation from an American historian, Carl Becker, who was primarily active around the turn of the 20th century and into the first half of the 20th century. I know that it's probably poor form to read it out loud, but I like it so much that I will anyway. "If we would discover the little backstairs door that for any age serves as the secret entranceway to knowledge, we will do well to look for certain unobtrusive words with uncertain meanings that are permitted to slip off the tongue or the pen without fear and without research. Words which, having from constant repetition lost their metaphorical significance, are unconsciously mistaken for objective realities." This is actually, I guess, in some ways really the theoretical starting point for really my understanding of tributary relations, tributary practices, the tributary system. So in 1926, in his annual address to the annual meeting of the American Historical Association, Carl Becker revealed his process of critical discursive analysis. It is a practice that we might now recognize as a pre-linguistic turn form of deconstruction. As an intellectual historian, Becker had keen interest in words and concepts as markers of an age, or of what he called the climate of opinion. He had less interest in the words of only rare occurrence than he did in the more quotidian that everyone felt they knew and understood. In cases of commonly familiar words, he felt it best to take time off to consider them. And in these spells of contemplation, he found that, quote, as often as not, I have been talking about words rather than real things, unquote. We may profitably follow Becker's consideration of commonly trafficked lexica as we delve into the production and deployment of knowledge in relation to the historical ontology of the tributary system. And now nearly 50 years have passed since the publication of the edited volume, The Chinese World Order, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. This is in which John K. Fairbank presented his preliminary framework for a Chinese tributary system that encompassed both a geopolitical model of interstate relations and something of a cosmological and civilizational order in which putatively Chinese empires and their neighbors located themselves and each other. For Fairbank, this Chinese world order constituted a Chinese grand design, that's his term, that whether fully implemented or not, was an ideal form that dominated the conceptualization and execution of interstate relations for centuries, if not millennia. In the very same volume, however, Mark Mancall began his essay with a warning of the intellectual problems that still resonate today, some five decades later. Mancall wrote, "The analyst must constantly bear in mind that the concept of the tribute system is a Western invention for descriptive purposes." There was, Mancall continued, no word or phrase in Chinese that might be rendered as tributary system, and there was no concept of such a system operating as a distinct institution. Thus, even in what may well be considered the text of the idea of the tributary system, there is no consensus on its ontological status. By the 1990s, the doubts concerning the integrity and the very existence of the tributary system and its ideological underpinnings were so great that few historians would use it as an analytical framework, especially after the controversial yet very influential work of James Hevia. In recent years, however, no less than three monographs have appeared that have brought the model of the tributary system and its Sinocentric world order back for reconsideration. Political scientists and international relations scholars, most notably David Kong, as well as Christopher Ford and Yuankong Wang, have embarked on ambitious projects to shed light upon the potential foreign policies and geostrategic thought of the People's Republic of China, now and in the future, through examinations of sundry tapestries interwoven with strands of Confucianism, the tributary system, Sinocentric notions of civilization and barbarism across multiple Chinese pasts, ranging from the pre-imperial period through the Song, Yuan, Ming, and Qing empires. Within the disciplinary context of international relations, which as a discipline I'll call IR, we might more charitably look upon David Kong's reanimation of the tributary system model as a call to theoretical pluralism. His central claim is that unlike the near constant warfare of the, I guess we might call an egalitarianism of the Westphalian system, the hierarchical tributary system provided relative stability to the region with little warfare in comparison to Westphalian Europe. We may indeed interpret Kong's call to the field of IR to take the tributary system seriously to be something of an intervention in a deeply Eurocentric scholarly practice. To the historian, however, the reintroduction of these concepts has come as something of a surprise, given the spirited and at times indecorous debates over the decades. In particular, I'm thinking about the fighting between Escherich and Hevia in the wake of the publication of Hevia's work. It surprises foremost, though, really, for its significant lapse of historiographical memory. The debates over these concepts among historians, already present to some degree even within the Chinese world order, the text, they were very lengthy, and the notion of the tributary system model is now broadly accepted as at least problematic, if not wholly unacceptable. Moreover, the current reintroduction of the tributary system has come with little acknowledgement of the politics of the production of historical knowledge about tribute. For some, and perhaps Kong in particular, the tributary system is a matter of historical fact. And this factual nature removes it from the vagaries of the political. But the tributary system has been central to, if not a product of, orientalist discourses of China for more than a century. These most recent statements of tributary systems and Chinese world orders reference history and policy discussions that predate the arguably Cold War sensibilities of the chapters of the Chinese World Order and reach back farther to the late Victorian era when diplomats and commentators of the Anglophone world saw the tributary system as a formula to be solved in relations with the Qing Empire and a problem to be overcome by the Qing court as it entered into the global modernity of the close of the 19th century. Let us then turn to the question of the relationship of the historical and the political in the newly emergent tributary system model. In his discussion of the current disputes over maritime boundaries in East and Southeast Asia, David Kong lays before us his understanding of the characteristics of the historical and the political. The maritime boundary issues are not really historical problems, he argues, but rather political issues. Silently invoking 19th century German historiography, Kong explains that historiography is a matter of establishing facts so that we might know what really occurred. A truly historical question then is, per Kong's example, did the Nanjing Massacre actually happen? In contrast, he explains, international boundary conflicts are firmly rooted in present political concerns. The issue then is not so much a matter of historical fact, but of present interpretation, or the remembering of past historical facts. Were these territorial problems truly historical, Kong maintains, quote, they would be much easier to solve, just find better historians and archaeologists, unquote. Thus, Kong's historian produces not history, but texts about history. He calls upon us to accept in trust history thus construed, while warning that historiography is to be tested to establish the degree to which it adheres to the actualities of the past. Having established the difference between history as fact and historiography as interpretation, Kong locates his historical facts squarely and verifiably in the past, while their interpretation is unavoidably in the present and, moreover, quintessentially political. East Asian maritime boundary disputes, he concludes, are then, quote, a modern political problem, not an ancient historical issue. This better historian or archaeologist, thus consigned to the ancient and historical, is the person who uncovers the apolitical past within the apolitical past, the historical facts over which we in the political present clash. In this sort of understanding of history and the historical, it is the task of the historian, as Carl Becker remarks, to find facts and, quote, arrange them conveniently so that someone, perhaps the sociologist or the economist, may easily carry them away for use in some structural exercise, unquote. The facts, however, are not waiting hither and yon for the day when they are uncovered and added to the storehouse of human knowledge. Again, in Becker's words, the dead manuscripts do not wish to be known. Rather, it is the subject who wishes to know, and it is this will that imposes itself upon that which is to be known, shaping the facts in its own image. The historian, present at the creation, both produces and interprets historical fact, and moreover, does so firmly in the present. If we are to accept historical facts as ontologically and temporally independent, we are obliged to elide not only the historian as subject, but also the entirety of the socio-political context into which they come, in which they come to be. Kong endows the tributary system with ontic status, but we may understand this as akin to what Lukács has called a phantom objectivity that conceals the scholars and scholarship that created the model. Or perhaps, rather than concealing or erasing the socio-political relations of scholars and scholarship, an uncritical acceptance of the phantom objectivity of the tributary system requires a kind of forgetfulness, or the so-called kind of transcendent condition of science, that is, reification. What then do we forget as we adopt the tributary system as an objective optic of East Asian interstate relations, both past and future? We lose the memory of tribute as an object of analysis brought into being by the very scholars who wrote of it, of its distinctly modern provenance in the late Victorian Anglo-American literatures on East Asia, and of the politics of the orientalist discourses in which the concept circulated. Tribute thus becomes limit and explanation. Chinese, Korean, Vietnamese policymakers in the past and potentially in the future are rendered both explainable and conceptually confined by the weight of an imagined tributary antiquity. In the search for the origins of a discourse of the tributary model, we may profitably look to June 1890, when the Joseon Queen Dowager Jo died at the age of 82. In accordance with established precedent, the Qing court sent envoys to deliver a letter of condolence from the Guangxu Emperor. King Gojong greeted the envoys outside the walls of Seoul and publicly prostrated himself before the letter. As the international status of the Joseon state was then a problem, I use in quotation marks, discussed among the Qing, Japanese, British, American, and Russian governments, this event was watched with considerable interest as a litmus test for the Joseon attitude toward the Qing Empire and the relevance of the tributary relationship in Northeast Asian geopolitics. There were numerous indications throughout the 1880s that the Joseon court was chafing under increasingly intrusive and unprecedented Qing military, economic, and political interventions. So when King Gojong prostrated before the imperial letter of condolence, Western observers were skeptical that he had done so willingly. Indeed, they chided the Qing court for forcing Joseon to continue to engage in archaic and pointless ritual. There was soon a shift in English language writings on the event, however, in which Gojong's prostration was held to be conclusive evidence that the Joseon state willingly submitted to Qing imperial authority as part of an ancient yet living tradition of the East Asian tributary relationship. For Western writers, the condolence mission and its reception constituted a spectacular display of a persistent and ultimately unknowable Asian antiquity, defying the otherwise global modernity of the close of the 19th century. King Gojong, however, was not a willing participant in the rites. Over the course of the 5 months from the Queen Dowager's death until the arrival of the Qing envoy, the Joseon king and court repeatedly negotiated with the Qing imperial resident, Yuan Shikai, and the Qing commissioner for northern ports, Li Hongzhang, and even pleaded to the Guangxu emperor directly to cancel the mission. Joseon and Qing officials spent such time and energy in debate because they were acutely aware of the impact the public display of tributary ritual would have on Western interpretations of Qing claims to suzerainty over Joseon. But despite continual Joseon resistance, Qing officials planned and executed the condolence mission as a propaganda exercise, really largely for Western consumption, in order to secure recognition of Qing authority over Joseon. It is this Qing representation of the condolence mission and the tributary relationship, in effect a conscious presentation of the Orient as difference, which has come to inform decades of English language scholarship on late 19th century Joseon-Qing relations. Now, the contestation of the 1890 condolence mission was perhaps the climax of Qing-Joseon negotiations of tributary practice that started as early as 1881, if not actually even the late 1870s. Li Hongzhang and his staff had been interested in changing the Qing relationship with Joseon as a matter of Qing security. They felt that Joseon was militarily weak and especially vulnerable to Russian invasion. Should Joseon fall to Russia, they reasoned, Beijing would soon be next. Since the Qing Empire had neither the military might nor the diplomatic capital to annex Joseon outright, actually as some of Li Hongzhang's staff had advocated, they settled upon a strategy whereby Joseon should cultivate trilateral relations with Qing, Japan, and the United States as to thwart Russian territorial ambitions. Li had Huang Zunxian compose the text Chaoxian Siyue, or the Joseon Strategy, in Korean the Joseon Chengyak. I'm sorry that my Chinese pronunciation is just terrible, so I'll go with Joseon Chengyak, or Joseon Strategy. So he had Huang Zunxian communicate this to the Joseon throne through this essay. So Joseon Strategy is at once an ominous call to action in the fate of a dire threat, but it is almost an almost infectually optimistic vision of the place Joseon could inhabit in a global community bound by international law. It is not difficult to see, really, why King Gojong was to find the essay convincing. Huang identified Russian expansionism as the most important and urgent foreign policy problem facing the Joseon state. It was only a matter of time, he argued, before Russian armies advanced south over the Tumen River. The best approach to such a disaster was to, quote, be intimate with China, tied with Japan, and allied with the United States. Now, for those of you who have read Joseon diplomatic history, you probably know that phrase in your sleep. It's a very, very commonly studied aspect of this text. But there's actually, I think, a lot more to the text that is far more interesting that I will come to here. But these relationships could then be the foundation of a self-strengthening that would usher a newly wealthy and powerful Joseon onto the world stage as a commercial power and a defender of stability in East Asia. A door had opened, Huang pleaded, and Joseon had only to step across the threshold into glories heretofore unimagined. Now, the essay actually is rather lengthy, and I'm not going to go through all of the various sort of methods of persuasion that Huang engaged in, but I'm going to tell you about two that I think are the most relevant for this evening's talk, and that is really about how it is that Huang tried to convince the Joseon court to engage in the relationship with the United States. And this really, by far, was the most difficult task that Huang had. Because, the recent American incursions in 1866 and 1871 had most certainly not faded from Korean memory. So Huang had to present an especially strong argument. He began with a seductive narrative of the United States as a global beacon of benevolence and wisdom. So Huang wrote, "Beyond the sea, east of Joseon, is America, which is governed as a federal state. That land was originally a British colony, but 100 years ago there was a man named Washington who did not wish to accept the rapacious government of Europeans. He summoned his spirit and succeeded in establishing an independent state. Ever since, the Americans have kept the bequeathed teachings of the kings of yore and have maintained their state with propriety and righteousness. They do not covet the lands and people of others, and they do not forcefully intervene in the governmental affairs of other states. In the more than 10 years since the United States has concluded a treaty with China, we have not had even the slightest problem. In their intercourse with the Japanese, they have encouraged commerce, urged military training, and helped to renegotiate treaties. This fact is known equally to all countries of the world." I'm not so sure that many of us would agree with that evaluation now, but it was moving, I suppose. On this basis alone, Huang urged Joseon to treat American envoys with respect and kindness should they happen to arrive. But he urged the Joseon government to quickly conclude a treaty with the United States because of the overarching American concerns for international justice and the defense of the weak, born of its own colonial experience. An American government bound by treaty obligation to aid Joseon would surely send help against Russian advances. Huang suspected that the Joseon government might also fear the costs of hosting American envoys. Hosting Qing envoys was costly and time-consuming, but Huang explained that such protocols were not necessary. And this is actually a passage from Joseon Chengnyak that I think is really quite stunning. But Huang wrote, "Long ago, bringing sacrificial animals, jade, and silk to the frontier to honor powerful states and to protect one's own people was a ritual practice of the ancients in which the small served the great. In the present, however, this practice no longer exists. Now small states like Belgium, Switzerland, and Holland are all independent and do not heed the excessive demands of large states. In the case of diplomatic missions, all the expenses of legations and resident envoys are borne by the sending countries themselves. Envoys pay their respect at court once upon their arrival and only attend one official banquet at the end of their one-year term. There are no welcoming rituals outside the city gates, and it is not necessary to send gifts." I think for many of you who are familiar with tributary practice, this is pretty much what tribute is all about, right? Now, Huang here, I think, really he meant only to suggest that it would not be expensive for Joseon to allow the establishment of foreign embassies and to host ambassadors from Western powers. But the well-nigh unavoidable implication is that there is no place in the modern world for tributary practice. This description of the foreign relations of small European states undercut the tributary model in three, I think, really rather important ways. The first and most obvious is that, well, the practice no longer exists. Right? In the modern world, there is no tributary practice. Right? In the context of an essay addressed to a tributary state and designed to fundamentally transform the course of its foreign relations in changing times, this is a damning evaluation. Second, use of the term zili or jarib, which is what I've translated as independent, suggests not only that small states stand on their own, as a literal translation of the term suggests, but also that their rulers do not receive investiture. They are legitimate in their own right without having to depend on enfeoffment from an external source. Now, I will, as a matter of honesty here, I'm not entirely sure that my interpretation of this term zudi or tarib is really correct, but I find it really rather interesting, and I suspect that this is the way it goes, but if any of you have comments or corrections, I would be eager to hear them. Third, in the modern world, envoys need neither be treated with great ceremony nor plied with costly gifts. Huang cited these examples in particular because they were key facets of the ritual protocols with which Joseon hosted Qing envoys. They were also important, however, as the enactment of Joseon's submission to the Qing throne. If they were no longer part of the international order that Joseon was about to join, why should they be maintained at all? Huang outlined the changes that would soon have to take place with the onset of new relations. In addition to exchanging embassies with Japan and the United States, there would have to be some, quote, slight changes to the existing regulations governing Qing-Joseon interactions. First, Huang urged Kozhong to memorialize the Qing throne and request that a permanent Joseon envoy be allowed to reside in Beijing. Second, Huang proposed the opening of Qing-Joseon trade. The periodic frontier markets, first established in the 17th century, would be abolished, and Qing merchants could break Japanese dominance then of trade in Pusan, Wonsan, and Incheon. Moreover, Joseon merchants could start businesses in Nagasaki and Yokohama. With the increasing intercourse between Joseon, Qing, Japan, and the United States, Joseon students could study abroad, learn foreign languages, shipbuilding, weapons manufacture, military training, mining, chemistry, astronomy, and geography. Eventually, schools could be opened in places like Busan where students could be trained domestically, and Joseon would be well down the path of self-strengthening. Huang's slight changes, however, were really quite radical. Having previously stated that tributary relations no longer exist in the modern world, he proposed the establishment of a Joseon embassy in Beijing, a move which would eliminate the need for the dispatch of Qing and Joseon missions over land between Beijing and Seoul. Huang made no reference to what the new protocols might be, but at the very least, the Joseon government would not have to host Qing embassies, and the king would no longer be greeting them outside the walls of Seoul. With this formulation of a modern world where tribute was now only a distant practice of the ancients, Joseon and Qing were to abolish so many of the tributary protocols that had defined so much of their interaction that really Huang appeared to be ushering Joseon into an entirely new place in the world. King Kozhong accepted the proposals in Joseon strategy with enthusiasm. And over the period of 1881 to 1882, he mobilized support within the Joseon court, and he also really frankly brutally crushed the opposition of provincial scholars who were not interested in these proposals, oftentimes actually using torture and execution to make his point. But finally in 1882, he dispatched the envoy Ao Yunzhong to Tianjin and Beijing to propose ending tributary missions, opening an embassy in Beijing, abolishing frontier markets, and opening direct trade and travel between Qing and Joseon by removing the maritime ban. Must have really been a deeply shocking development, however, when Ao Yunzhong met with officials in Beijing and also in Tianjin, they obstructed him, actually, at every turn. And he found eventually that many of his proposals were rejected outright. And this is really kind of a shocking turn of events because the Joseon government at this point felt that this was going to be kind of a rubber stamp exercise. I mean, after all, Huang Junxian had said, you should do this. They did it. And then Qing refused. So why? The source of opposition within the Qing government was the Board of Rights. Vice Minister of Rights Bao Ding submitted a memorial to the Qing throne in which he explained that over the course of the past two centuries, Joseon had distinguished itself with, quote, exemplary submission. And the intimacy of the Qing-Joseon relationship was thus unique in the history of Qing tributary relations and spoke to the skills of the Board of Rights as kind of almost like Joseon hands, like Korea hands. He portrayed the Board of Rights as having this kind of unique experience to manage Joseon Korea. He noted, however, that with the commencement of relations with the West, that the harmony over which the Qing Empire had once presided was collapsing. The Japanese had annexed Liuzhou, the British were harassing Burma, the French had sent their armies against Vietnam, while Qing, in his words, quote, did not dare to come to their aid and had failed to repel the invaders. The next threats were to be expected from Russian and Japanese interventions in Joseon, which, Baoding pointed out, was poor and weak and in no position to mount its own defense. While the security implications of these developments were clear, Baoding saw a further danger in the Qing inability to defend its tributary states. Every foreign provocation left unanswered constituted further erosion of Qing prestige and only encouraged further aggression. Moreover, even though Joseon had supposedly been loyal and submissive for centuries, Baoding predicted that continued Qing failure to check foreign interventions could lead even Joseon to reevaluate its submission to the Qing throne. So, if these incidents were wearing away Qing prestige and Joseon reverence, he asked, why was Joseon still sending tribute? Why? What's the point here? Baoding says, first, the fact that the Joseon state had no real military capability and was near destitution, so weak and poor. The second was that Joseon had a deep respect for ritual propriety and righteousness. These two seem actually like they don't really fit very well together, right? On the one hand, you have almost a kind of a realpolitik explanation. On the other hand, you have this kind of highfalutin appreciation for righteousness and propriety. So Baoding maintained, however, that in the case of Joseon, these two ideas here could not be considered separately. Ultimately, it was the very fact of Joseon's feebleness and indigence that required the maintenance of ritual propriety as a matter of national self-preservation. Tributary ritual for Baoding, then, was the expression and exercise of power. It was an act of domination and subjugation dictated by the raw realities of might and wealth, with no relation to philosophical or ideological commitment in either party. In Kojong's proposal, Baoding saw a Joseon bid not simply to change tributary rituals, but to alter the dynamics of the power that these rituals produced and expressed. So, Baoding then made two policy suggestions. And these two policy suggestions are really at the foundation of the way in which the Qing state approached Joseon all the way up until 1895. The first was that Joseon relations should not be reassigned to the Zhongliaman. I think, as you are probably well aware, the Zhongliaman was that office in the Qing government that was responsible for relations with Western states and Japan as well. If the Zhongliaman were to handle Joseon affairs, there would be no way to differentiate Qing-Joseon relations from Qing relations with Western countries and Japan. To all appearances, Joseon would enjoy the same status as Western states. He thus argued that Joseon should continue to direct communications through the Board of Rights and adhere to existing protocols. Second, Baoding counseled against constructing a separate embassy for a Joseon resident envoy. Joseon envoys were then hosted at the common residence for tributary envoys, the Huidong Sayokwan. In Baoding's analysis, the fact that the Joseon envoys obeyed the imperial command to reside in the common residence was an expression of submission and a demonstration of the familial intimacy of the Qing and Joseon courts. Now, it should be clear from Baoding's analysis of ritual and power that he doesn't really care about these things in and of themselves. He does not get soft and mushy about these sorts of things. But what he did care about deeply was the representation of these ideas. To eliminate the Board of Rights from Joseon affairs in favor of the Zhongliaman and also to permit the construction of a Joseon embassy to replace the common residence, would not present an image that produced and reinforced an understanding of Joseon as uniquely bound to the Qing court and fundamentally removed from other states. It was crucial that these protocols were seen by the larger diplomatic community. Baoding did not want to allow Joseon to vanish into an undifferentiated foreign diplomatic presence. Joseon had to be kept separate as well as seen to be separate, and this is really key, right? It was the maintenance of this image and sense of difference that was really at the core function of tributary protocols in Baoding's recommendations, and it came to be central to Qing presentations of its relations with Joseon even as late as 1899, which is 4 years right after the end of tributary relations. At that point, still, there was an attempt at the Qing court to reestablish them. So what ended up happening, really, was then that the Qing court said that revamping the economic relationships is wonderful, but they refused to change any of the tributary protocols and left it at that. Soon thereafter, actually, there was a soldiers' revolt in 1882, a coup attempt in 1884, and this led actually to two separate Qing military interventions in Seoul. And initially, actually, this had been welcomed by the Joseon court because essentially it had been saved twice. But what ended up happening, though, is that the interventionist presence of Yuan Shikai as the Qing imperial resident in Seoul from 1885 led to increasing abrasion between Qing and Joseon authorities until Joseon, with the help from hired American advisors and the United States legation, began to directly resist Qing claims to suzerain authority as enacted through tributary protocols. The conflict between these politics, between the politics of representation as laid out in Bao Ding's memorial, and the attempts of the Joseon court to break free came to a head then in the 1890 condolence mission for Queen Dowager Jo. Now, even as Queen Dowager Jo lay dying, Yuan Shikai envisioned a grand opportunity for a piece of political theater designed to demonstrate to the world the nature of the Joseon-Qing relationship. And in his proposal to Li Hongzhang, he explained that, you know, the entire world, as represented in the diplomatic community, is going to witness the rituals involved with the arrival of the commissioners or the envoys. And in particular, you know, King Kozhong was going to have to go and prostrate himself before the imperial condolence, and that this was a golden opportunity, really, to push the Qing line. What's kind of interesting here is that Yuan Shikai even had to frame this as a proposal, because there are a number of cases, actually, where Li Hongzhang did not seem to understand how the tributary protocols worked. And so when Yuan Shikai said, hey, you know, these commissioners, or he called them commissioners in these English translations, when these envoys come, all these things are going to happen, and the Western diplomatic community is going to see it. Li Hongzhang's response at that time was, can we do that? I mean, it's really peculiar. Like, this would actually have been a routine operation. But he said, is this something we can do? Why don't you go into the archives, see if you can find any precedent for this ever having happened? I've actually encountered several times where Li Hongzhang didn't really understand even the routine operations of these kinds of tributary practices. The Joseon government actually was well aware of what was going to happen and moved very quickly to subvert them, requesting multiple times to Yuan Shikai and Li Hongzhang to cancel the mission. They actually even went over their heads and sent an envoy directly to the Guangxu emperor to cancel the mission. But all of these attempts to cancel the mission failed. And again, you know, what's going on here is that the Qing officials and the Joseon officials know that the diplomatic community is going to watch, and that if Kozhong is going to perform this public prostration, it is going to be really detrimental to Joseon claims to sovereignty, essentially. But eventually, though, these protests failed, and indeed, the envoys arrived, and King Kozhong had to perform this ritual. And generally speaking, the arrival of the envoys went smoothly. All the rituals went as they were supposed to go, despite all of the Joseon protests. And when the Qing envoys returned and submitted the report to the Qing court, they wrote, "We have examined the situation in Joseon, and it seems they again fear the awesome and hold dear the virtuous. But the king is of a weak and spineless temperament, and his wife and officials abuse authority, so deceptions and passions have run amok. Now, as foreigners fan illusions, they may give rise to reckless hopes, but they do not dare to realize them from the outside. As we conducted ritual protocols with awesome ceremony and profound solemnity on this occasion, Westerners from around the world together witnessed it and have come to understand plainly that they can no longer deny Joseon's submission and service to the celestial court. From now on, we can simply follow the circumstances and profit, achieving the desired results. Joseon has long been subject to the great canopy of the Imperium, just as heaven is overhead and earth is underfoot. Now, with ever greater intensity, they eternally pledge their unwavering fidelity." Yuan shared the envoy's positive assessment of the mission, stating that the Seoul foreign community was in agreement that Joseon was indeed a tributary state. But in reference to King Kozhong's feelings about this new consensus, however, Yuan wrote, "The king is deeply upset about it." Rather than an act of voluntary submission, Kozhong's reception of the Qing condolence mission had been a coerced exercise in international humiliation. So this mission was indeed closely followed in Western diplomatic and missionary communities, both in Qing and Joseon, although neither had any analytical resources beyond their assumptions and their observations from afar. In his reports to President Harrison, the United States Minister Augustine Heard described the mission and its rituals as, quote, an act oriental between orientals that must never be judged by the Western standard, for to do so would be to misunderstand it. The people of East Asia in general, Heard explained, were deeply enmeshed in the practice of tribute and reverence for the emperor in ways that the Western mind could not comprehend. Tributary relations in general and respect for the emperor in particular were, quote, the result of the lifelong education for the individual intensified by centuries of hereditary practice. Tributary practices thus inherited over the centuries were so much a part of the Asian mindset that there was little hope in either altering or understanding them, at least not by any Western standard that Heard could muster. The Chinese Times, which is a British missionary publication in the Qing Empire, also understood the condolence mission of 1890 in terms of an antiquity in the present, but also expressed grave concern for the fate of the Qing state in a modern international community ordered by international law. In two editorials in November of 1890, the Chinese Times argued that tribute had once been an ingenious system by which Chinese empires of the past had maintained an international order, but the international community could not accept the continuation of Qing tributary pretensions. The lingering of the tributary system was a threat to international stability. Mired in the miasma of an eternally present antiquity, the Qing state appeared to the editors to be unable to imagine, let alone enact, foreign policy beyond the received tributary model. Qing simply could not cope with the new realities of the 19th century. The editors wrote, "It is nothing less than a new theory of heaven and earth which is presented to China these days, but she cannot all at once realize the truth that she is not the center of gravity after all, and she would rather hang the Galileos who tell her so than believe in them. It may be at least charitably hoped that she is in a transition stage and that she may become receptive to the new light before it is too late." As the Qing Empire emerged onto the modern world stage, the editors fretted, what would happen as this empire marinated in myth came unavoidably into contact with the rational, data-driven Galileos of the Western powers? What disaster could be in store for the anti-modern? Now, even though the disputes of the negotiations between Joseon and Qing really demonstrated that both governments were deeply aware of the geopolitical realities of their time, the reports of Augustine Heard and the Chinese Times really made Qing look like it was deeply conditioned by past centuries of tributary practice, and that nothing less than a cataclysm of some kind could awaken it to the realities of the 19th century present. Now, when Yuan Shikai had initially conceived of the condolence mission, he was correct, really, that the Western observers would be impressed by it, but what he couldn't really control was how these Western observers would interpret it. And, for the Chinese Times, for example, to be sort of taking the Joseon side and thinking that the Qing state was irrational and mired in this, backward-looking policy, this was not actually the intended outcome, right? So Yuan Shikai actually produced an English-language pamphlet. Now, when I first wrote about this, I have to say that this pamphlet, I didn't actually realize it was written by Yuan Shikai. I know that now, but it is way too late to change that since this was published some time ago. but anyhow, he published a 32-page English-language pamphlet that was distributed, actually, to the diplomatic community in Seoul. And in this pamphlet, he placed a strong emphasis on exacting and willing ritual compliance. Fully two-thirds of the pamphlet is composed of an account of the reception of the mission and its rituals. And unsurprisingly, the pamphlet makes no mention of the Joseon attempts to eliminate the public rituals. In place of repeated contestations, the Qing compilers actually constructed a tale in which Ko Zhong freely chose to conduct the Gyoyong Rite, or this rite of welcoming the imperial letter outside the gates. The pamphlet actually really continued on a very high note. It's written here that all the officials in attendance on serving the commissioners leaped with joy and gladness, while the people and merchants followed their avocations as usual, in quiet and peace. They congratulated each other in the marketplaces, declaring that the advent of the commissioners to Korea brought blessings to the land for which they felt joyously thankful. Now, the Qing pamphlet provided a giddy account that few Western observers near to the events really would have accepted, right? But for Yuan Shikai, fortunately, I suppose, another Western reader with more tenuous connections to the politics of the region was touring East Asia at that time. And this was George Nathaniel Curzon, who was a member of the House of Commons, the future Viceroy of India, and a self-described traveler with purpose. And he was traveling in East Asia at that time to do research for a book that he was calling The Problems of East Asia, or the problem, I'm sorry, Problems of the Far East. And in talking about, you know, his sort of conception of the international relationships in the Far East that might be of interest to British readers, he felt that you know, this notion of a tributary relationship was really key to understanding it. And he had actually one source of information, and that one source was this pamphlet that Yuan Shikai had sent out to the Western diplomatic community. And what ends up happening here is that that source becomes widely distributed after 1894 when his book is published. The book actually was highly successful. They got very, very strong reviews throughout Britain and the United States. And throughout, actually, not only, you know, in Curzon's book itself, but even in the reviews, there were extensive quotations from this pamphlet. So very, very quickly, actually, the sort of Qing notion of a kind of joyful Joseon submission that is kind of soaked in this deep ancient tradition is in wide circulation across the English-speaking world by 1894. But actually, it didn't stop there. So these ideas were taken up and cited again and again and again through the 19-teens, actually even the 1890s, 19-teens, the 1920s, works written in the 1940s, and actually most recently we can find a materialization, you know, a citing of George Curzon and also, well, and of this, this pamphlet in Kirk Larson's book from 2008, what... I always get the title, Tradition, Treaties, and Trade. So even into the 21st century, this particular kind of propaganda exercise from 1892 or from 1890 has been in circulation in contemporary English language scholarship. So now, more than a century after the editorials of the Chinese Times, and nearly half a century after the publication of the Chinese World Order, David Kong's East Asia Before the West and other recent publications in IR join what is now a hoary tradition of Anglophone fascination with the tributary system. Like his 19th century predecessor, Kong suggests that the tributary system and its Confucian foundations were rooted in a 2,000-year-old tradition and lasted for more than 600 years. In this formulation, the tribute system worked well to maintain a largely peaceful and stable international system. But Kong sees no possibility of its return. Rather, he speculates that the tributary system as historical reality has a role in the ways in which the diverse peoples of East Asia in the 21st century understand foreign relations. In asking, are we all Westphalians now? Kong suggests that among East Asian people, only a veneer of highly educated English-speaking people have access to Westphalian ideals that are denied to those without, quote, serviceable English language skills, unquote. Even with the monumental transformations that have characterized the political and intellectual history of the 19th and 20th centuries, Kong still does not actually see a Westphalian transformation of China and still wonders how China will integrate itself into the world system. And you know, here I think we can hear echoes of the Chinese Times, a similar kind of concern. How will Qing adapt to the international system? How will the PRC adapt to the international system? While he hesitates to draw a direct line from the tributary system to the foreign policy of the PRC in the 21st century, he does call upon his readers to ponder the possibility that such lines may indeed be drawn. Like the editors of the Chinese Times in the 19th century and Fairbank in the 20th century, Kong's 21st century invocation of the tributary system forever links, if not chains, China in the present to its various past. So to again adopt tribute as a lens through which we might understand or even predict the foreign policy of the People's Republic of China in the 21st century is to make the assumption that the model has been as important to policymakers of East Asia over the centuries as it has been to Anglophone historians, political scientists, and other sundry commentators since the 19th century. The diversity of tributary practice, and even the willingness to abandon tribute entirely as the situation demanded, suggests that the tributary system, much as Mancall and others have warned, is not so much a hegemonic East Asian institution as it is a Euro-American creation. 30 years after Paul Cohen heralded the liberation of China not from its own pasts, but from the past assigned to it by Western academics, we still struggle with an imagined tributary system of antiquity that will somehow stand in the way of the PRC as it tries to comprehend the international relations of the 21st century, as if somehow the PRC had not already done so. The current manifestation of the tributary system in recent international relations scholarship is thus not so much an innovation or even a reiteration of earlier Anglophone China historiography of the mid-20th century, really, as it is a return to an even older school of China watching that reproduces some of the more troubling tropes of colonial discourses. The tributary system harks back to a time when it was a geopolitically urgent question in the way that epistemic and strategic challenges to empire are often framed as questions. And these are questions that, you know, have moved self-appointed and inevitably uninformed experts to an ill-conceived punditry that plumbed the darkling depths of Orientalist fantasies of an Asian mindset eternally hogtied by antiquity and tradition. For generations of East Asia scholars, tribute has been among Carl Becker's words with uncertain meanings that are omnipresent in the virtual, you know, in the very intellectual air that we breathe. If these sorts of words indeed serve as the portal into a knowledge of a particular age, then the notion of a tributary system is a gateway to a body of knowledge about Asia produced in the late 19th century at the high water mark of global European imperialism. It is native to the knowledge of that age, a knowledge run through with discourses of non-Western institutional and intellectual inertia. And as such, it must be handled very carefully indeed. For while East Asia scholars may, despite their best efforts, remain resident in the Victorian era, global currents of the 21st century are obviously radically different from those of the 1890s. Rather than ask whether China can adjust to new realities, we might ask if it is we, as scholars, who can adjust to new realities. So in respecting the wishes of Becker's dead manuscripts, then, I will leave you by asking one further question. To what degree may we speak of the tributary system before the West? Thank you.
So thank you for a really interesting and provocative talk about something that I've studied a little bit. And I was really illuminating your rendition of the 1890s condolence missions. But I have like two questions. One is I do agree that political scientists often are sort of generalizing the tributary system in a way that I think is unhealthy and sort of creating this bloated 2,000-year-old template for foreign relations. On the other hand, I mean, you could say the same thing about the idea of a Westphalian treaty. I mean, the Treaty of Westphalia were two treaties, one with France and the Holy Roman Empire, and one with Sweden and the Holy Roman Empire. And that was a peace treaty which never mentioned the word sovereignty, never mentioned non-interference in internal affairs, and they were probably not even aware of the fact that they were creating a Westphalian order, you know. And that's the whole idea of a Westphalian order is the product of, you know, centuries and decades of scholarship and customary international law. And, you know, you don't have to look very far into Qing sources. Say, for instance, if you look at the letter of rejection of the Qianlong Emperor to Lord Macartney, yeah, in 1793. I mean, the Qianlong Emperor never says, you know, you're violating tributary system. But he uses the word tribute, and he uses the word system and practice, and saying what you're asking for is not consonance with how we do things here. Right. So they didn't clearly need a word for tributary system, but they're definitely referring to a thing that, you know, contains certain practices, sure, that the Qianlong Emperor outlines, you know. And then, of course, that doesn't mean that they agreed to that during the Tang Dynasty. So that's the number one. I think we should be careful about, I think we should push back at people like David Kong but I don't want to sort of push it too far because there is actually evidentiary basis among
there is a there.
Yeah, there is a there, and so what do we do with it? And the second thing is when you were referring to Li Hongzhang, seemingly ignorant about tributary protocol. I haven't seen the sources you've been looking at, but I have seen other sources where Li Hongzhang is negotiating treaties with Japan, and he is fully aware of the existence of tributary protocol, and that that it's a thing. So I wonder whether perhaps another reading of your source, which I haven't looked at, would rather be that you know the idea of a Korean king prostrating himself in front of a mission of condolences. You know, that in itself, I don't think was unprecedented or anything like that. But putting it in front of foreign envoys creates a precedent because are the foreign envoys supposed to prostrate themselves? You know, how would the foreign envoys react to that? Because these are two different worlds that sort of collapse into each other. I think that is what Li Hongzhang is thinking. You know, how do we do this?
Well,
right. So.
Well, first off, as far as any perusal of the source material, concerning interstate relations, well, not any, but many, you're going to come across tributary practice. And I prefer actually the term tributary practice to tributary system. Because, there's definitely, there's the submission of tributary goods, and there's, the bestowal of the calendar, and there's, patents of investiture, and all these things that we associate with a tributary relationship. But I prefer tributary practice to system because I think if you look over the wide variety of tributary relationships, there's a huge amount of difference. And moreover, I think also, if we think about actually now the late Dr. Will's work, that there's also Qing relationships that are not even within a tributary context. So we can look at interstate relations that are not tributary at all. We can look at, we could compare, say, like Joseon to Laos, where, Joseon is sending multiple missions every year, and Laos does once in 10 years. I'm really hesitant to say that there's a coherent system. But there's definitely a practice that is, I think we can identify as a tributary practice, but it has a tremendous amount of variety. As for Li Hongzhang, he specifically asked in this particular communication whether or not there was precedent for sending envoys upon the death of a queen dowager. And so that sent Yuan Shikai to probably have his minions, I imagine, go and look through it, and then Yuan Shikai responded with particular examples. In this year, so-and-so died, and we sent an envoy. So I think that he, in this particular case, I feel fairly strongly that he didn't know about that particular protocol. I mean, sure, he knew about tributary practice and that there are tributary relationships. There's no question about that. And in fact, actually, he, in some of the policy discussions that he engaged in with Zhong Liaoman and some of his staff around 1880, he was very much aware of these things, and he was concerned actually about the loss of tributary status because he wasn't so sure. I mean, he felt that actually calling the Joseon state a tributary state was not going to be enough to deter Western states from intervening, but he still wanted to maintain some kind of a hierarchical relationship. And at that point, I think in some ways he was exploring for how to make that really happen. The other instance that I'm aware of was in 82, they were about the same time period, when this was at the time when Li Hongzhang was negotiating the treaty with the United States on behalf of the Joseon government. And at the time of these negotiations, there were Joseon envoys in Tianjin, but he asked them about plenipotentiary powers, and they said, no, we don't, we're just tribute envoys, we don't do that. And Li Hongzhang was quite irritated because then he couldn't have Joseon participation in the negotiations. And to my mind, at that time, for him to have asked that question would indicate that he didn't really know what the function was of tributary envoys, that he had some sort of other understanding of what they were about and what they were doing. Later, actually, there's one of the envoys who offered the letter of condolence wrote an extensive diary of his travels in Korea, and Li Hongzhang wrote the introduction to that. And what's interesting is that in that introduction, Li Hongzhang actually gives this long exposition about how we've been doing this since the beginning of time and how important it is. So I'm assuming that by the time, I think this came out maybe in 1890, by that time I think he maybe had done his homework, but I think earlier on though, I mean, if you think about his career, he was not really involved in the goings-on of the Board of Rights or the reception of tributary envoys. It's not really what he did, and I sort of see him as being kind of institutionally and also in terms of his job experience, kind of apart from that.
For recording purposes, I hear it's necessary. Okay. Okay, great. So thank you for a very interesting talk. I was just wondering whether the Orientalist discourse surrounding the tribute circulates beyond and back to Asia and becomes kind of a basis for a discourse on a regionalism of a different sort. And I'm thinking in specifically in that regard to the Chenha system or Tianxia system. Mm-hmm. My pronunciation is horrible, so the resurgence of the notion of the Chenha system or the Tianxia system, mm-hmm. As a way of thinking about Asia, East Asian order, mm. or revisiting the Sinic order that precedes or that is independent of American presence in East Asia. So whether tribute system can become part of, can be re-embraced outside of the Orientalist version of it, but in circulation, might the Orientalist origin of it might be deployed differently.
Well, I do know, I spoke at, I guess it was at AAS some time ago with Wang Yuanzhong at the University of Delaware. And he's also right now working on these kinds of issues. He and I have a very different interpretation of the Queen Dowager Jo condolence mission. He believes actually that it was really, in fact, insignificant and that it was merely routine. And he sees, I think in many ways he kind of takes, of course it's unfair to do this when he's not here, right? But he takes a lot of the tributary rhetoric or the sort of tributary discourse that you find in the source materials kind of literally. And so at an AAS presentation, he was asking the question, why is it that the Qing Empire did not simply annex Joseon as a province? Because that proposal was in discussion in different circles. We could just solve this problem right now, we'll just take it. As I've said, actually, that the reason actually that didn't happen was that Li Hongzhang and many of his staff understood both politically and militarily they just didn't have that wasn't an option. But Wang has suggested that Qing policymakers thought about this option and they thought, we're better than that. Like he's engaging this kind of a moral discourse about sort of justice and an interest in righteousness and this kind of rectitude. I think I see in his work, in some ways, kind of an acceptance of tributary discourse. Maybe not the Orientalist discourse that I'm talking about per se, but if you sort of accept uncritically the tributary discourses that you actually find in these documents, that there does seem to be some indication that some people are thinking, maybe this is actually really the situation. That this really is, for example, about the emperor caring for Joseon and caring for King Kojong as if it was his own son, et cetera, and bestowing benevolence and all that good stuff. I think it was 2015, the Journal of Contemporary China, there were several articles, actually one by Peter Perdue that also levels a similar kind of critique of David Kong, but also some indications that there are in right now in contemporary Chinese policy circles, in the PRC, people are indeed thinking about this kind of, maybe not necessarily a tributary system per se, but understanding China as a kind of a hegemon who is not necessarily basing their power upon military superiority, but instead on this kind of, almost a kind of a moral or ethical approach. So I do think that those ideas are indeed in circulation. I don't know how to answer your question necessarily about maybe about sort of Orientalist discourses coming back. And then, I will say this. I know I'm much more familiar, frankly, with Korean language scholarship than I am with Chinese language scholarship, which is, that's a problem on my part that I have to address. But I have seen in Korean scholarship, in the last probably it's been 5, 6, 7 years ago, two different studies about the condolence mission of 1890 both of which say that, this mission was like the last expression of an ancient order. And they look at it as kind of almost wistfully, like, wow, you know, that's how it used to be. They look at it as a kind of, they accept it with an uncritical sense of authenticity, like this is the real thing, and it's the last time it ever happened was here in Joseon in 1890.
Just a brief question. During the 1880s, of course, the same time that you're describing, I believe you made reference to it, the Qing-Vietnam tribute relations was completely disrupted.
Yeah.
Would there have been on the Qing side sort of an urgent need to shape up tribute practice?
Well, yeah. I mean, actually, I think that comes out fairly clearly in Bao Ding's memorial. I didn't cover the entirety of the memorial. It's a rather dense document. But he is very much concerned about the loss of Vietnam and does really feel that it has set a precedent. And he's very much afraid that that Joseon will fall next, whether it be at the hands of the Russians or potentially at the hands of the Japanese. And actually, throughout these policy considerations, most of them begin with how vulnerable Beijing itself would be if Joseon were to fall to a hostile power. So that's always running through these discourses, I think.
Maybe, yeah, you were first, then.
Thanks for the talk. I have a really naive question about what you mean by orientalist. I'm not an expert on Said, but I do seem to remember that orientalism is a sort of fantasy or projection by non-orientals, whoever they are, upon orientals, whoever they are. But just looking at some of the developments that you talked about in your talk, you know, the Europeans apparently thought, or the foreign observers, the non-regional foreign observers thought that Kozhong didn't want to prostrate, and he didn't. And then when Yuan Shikai wrote an account talking about how he actually wanted to prostrate, they just accepted it. So I don't see much fantasy or projection in those contexts. Can you talk about that?
Sure, yeah. It's the initial observations from the American minister, Augustine Heard, are interesting to look at because he had been actually intimately involved with the Joseon government's efforts actually to thwart Qing intervention in the Queen Dowager's funeral, which I didn't talk about at all, the state funeral. So he knew that Kozhong was not interested in participating in these rites. And he was thrown for a loop when Kozhong did in fact do it. And the larger context of the report to President Harrison was trying to explain to Harrison why it was that the United States should not be alarmed that a country with which they had signed a treaty appeared to be a tributary state to another power. And so other parts of Augustine Heard's letter that I did not go into, whereas where Heard is trying to explain that even though Kozhong has engaged in these rituals, we shouldn't take it to mean really much of anything. It's just kind of it's sort of a habit. It's what Asian people do, right? Asian people sort of can't help but be subservient to authority. And so I think in there you get certain kinds of orientalist discourses there about passivity and about lack of critical thought, for example, or lack of independent thought. The editorials in the Chinese Times, they are very sympathetic to the Joseon government, but they are not sympathetic to the Qing government. They think that the Qing government, this is where you really sort of find this orientalist discourse I'm talking about, is in their evaluation of the Qing, that the Qing government is mired in this backward-looking sort of desire to maintain antiquity, that the Qing policymakers are actually don't even have policy, they just have behavior, right? I mean, it almost makes me think about discourses about North Korea that in the American press where North Korea doesn't have policy, it has behaviors. I think that you have a similar kind of way of speaking about Qing at that time. The turning point was Yuan Shikai's pamphlet. And so what ends up really happening then is that once Curzon takes up that pamphlet, it gets spread throughout English language scholarship for like the next 100 years. And what's interesting too is I think that this is something I'm going to be honest with you. I don't have 100% proof that Yuan Shikai knew that Western scholars would sort of lap up this notion of an unknowable, mysterious Orient. But I strongly suspect it. One reason I suspect it is something I did not mention in the talk today is that during the state funeral for the Queen Dowager, Yuan Shikai demanded that he march along with the casket as the body was taken from the palace out to, you know, through the east gate and to the tomb where she would be interred. And the Joseon government at this point, you know, refused him every single time. He said, I'm going to march. The only question I have is, should I be in front of the casket or behind the casket? You know, and the Joseon official said, yeah, you're not going to march anywhere. It's not going to be in front. It's not going to be behind. You just ain't going to do it. So what ended up happening then was that Yuan Shikai, he also refused to watch the procession with the other members of the diplomatic community. So the United States, Augustine Heard, he had organized all the other members of the foreign diplomatic community to assemble at the East Gate and to pay their respects as the casket passed by. And this was very sort of deeply upsetting to Yuan Shikai. He said, I am not going to do this. Because why? Because he doesn't want to appear like the relationship with the Qing is just like the relationship with every other country. So he said that he was going to set up essentially an altar where he would make offerings on the side of the road as the cortege passed. And he said to Augustine Heard, when he refused Augustine Heard's invitation to join him, he said, look, you know, there are things that you cannot understand about our relationship. Now, even though at that point, you know, frankly, Yuan Shikai was completely improvising, because there's absolutely zero precedent for any kind of Qing participation in a state funeral, and certainly no precedent for setting up a table at the side of the road and making offerings as the cortege passed. So actually, from that incident in particular, I suspect that Yuan Shikai did have this sense of wanting to keep the Western diplomatic community kind of at bay and keep them guessing by creating this facade of mystery, of unknowableness. But I do confess, though, I don't really have a good smoking gun. You know, like, I would love to, for example, like the Bao Ding Memorial was a fabulous find for me, because I actually get then Bao Ding saying, here's how we are going to represent this particular relationship for this reason. And so that was a wonderful find. But I have not found something similar to suggest that, that would prove definitively that Yuan Shikai or anybody else was saying that we are going to manipulate Western fantasies about us. But I strongly suspect it. Oh, I'm sorry.
So I have a comment on the, I guess, like, precedence. Is that I suspect the reason that Li Yongzhang didn't really if he didn't know the details, is because the people who actually know, like, the system, or which I would prefer to think as bodies of precedence, these mm-hmm. are the clerks who work for these mm-hmm. institutions. So for Korea, for example, like, for Joseon, it would be Board of Rights. For mm-hmm. Vietnam, it would be mm-hmm. Clerks working for governor generals mm-hmm. in the mm-hmm. Southwest. And for Kokand, it would be Xinjiang. Mm-hmm. So like that. And also, one other thing I want to comment on is that, in a way, what makes tributary relationship not, I guess, like, unequal or hierarchical is that both parties can, use the precedence to their own advantage, but only one party has, like, power to create precedence. Mm-hmm. And at this point, Qing doesn't have that anymore, and I think that might be, something to think about.
But you mean, so Qing doesn't have the power to create precedent anymore?
Well, they do, but not in a real sense. If you look at, a lot of cases in 17th century and in mm-hmm. 18th century, Qing can create precedents and mm-hmm. can force those precedents on the tributary states. But because of the changed circumstances in late 19th century, both international and domestic, that might not be feasible anymore. And that would apply to not just, tributary politics that we think of as foreign today, yeah. but also tributary politics that are within the Qing border, for example, or mm-hmm. Tribes and so on.
Yeah, hang on just a second. I like this idea about not being able to enforce precedent. I think that's very important. As far as the Li Hongzhang thing, I think that Li Hongzhang, if you look at his career, as I mentioned before, he really was not involved in these kinds of things. So in some ways, it's not unusual that he would not know. I guess in some ways, the reason I'd like to bring this up is that I am in some ways reacting to existing literatures that we have, at least in English, that suggest, for example, that Li Hongzhang was the sort of mastermind of this two-pronged approach. in which we are going to enforce tributary protocols and we are going to have treaty relationships. And, you know, looking at these debates, especially in this period from 1880 to 1882, it's just really not the case that he was not so interested in enforcing actually any kind of tributary protocols. And to be honest, I still do not understand exactly what happened between the time that King Kojong sent Ouyunzhong to negotiate the end of the tributary relationship and the time that Ouyunzhong arrived. Something happened in the Qing court, and I still don't know what it is that, where, you know, you get Bao Ding and the Board of Rights getting the upper hand. And actually, you know, at that time, the official line was that Li Hongzhang's mother had died, and therefore he had gone to his hometown to attend to his mother's funeral. And so, you know, actually, Kojong, when he gave his instructions to Ouyunzhong, he said, you have to speak to Li Hongzhang. He is our man. He has our best interests at heart. You have got to speak to him. And when Ouyunzhong got there, he was only able to speak to Zhou Fu, who obstructed him at every end and really stopped him from going to the Zhongliaomen, for example, and said that really you can only go to the Board of Rights. And then this is when Bao Ding, you know, and actually there were other officials at the Board of Rights that submitted some other memorials as well, though Bao Ding's is the best one, but I think the most informative. So something happened there, and you know, I've never fully believed that the reason that Li Hongzhang was not there was because of his mother's funeral. I mean, it struck me that, you know, he was such an important figure at that point that I can't believe that he would just take off, and especially for the arrival of the Joseon envoy that was supposed to meet him. So, but yeah, honestly, I'm not really sure exactly how that change happened.
Yeah, thanks for the talk. I just wanted to ask about, I just wanted to add on to the question that, you know, my teacher had over there about, you know, you said that you would call a tributary system, but not, you wouldn't call it a tributary system, but you would call it a tributary sort of,
a practice.
Practice, yeah. Yes. And I just wanted to ask what the difference was, you know, one, I mean, it sounds like, because the system sounds like basically a practice that you do over and over again, and, you know, so you basically have certain rules for, you know. It could change overall, but you know, it's still pretty much set idea of you do this, and I guess I don't see what the difference is when you substitute those two words.
Well, actually, it's a good question because I think for those scholars who argue for the existence of the tributary system, they say, well, look, there's a set of protocols. We all know what they are, and that if you look at the vast majority of, you know, Ming and Qing relations with neighboring states, that they use these particular practices, so actually why not call it a system? And I suppose what really it comes down to is what is a system? What is the nature of a system? I'll admit that sometimes I'm still a little fuzzy on exactly what a system is, especially within the field of political science or within, you know, the field of IR. But the reason, though, that I'm unwilling to accept this notion of a tributary system is that the variation in relationships was enormous, number one. Plus, there were a lot of relationships between Ming and Qing states and their neighbors that did not necessarily even involve anything that we could sort of identify as tributary. But on a more theoretical level, you know, aside from the empirical issues, on a more theoretical level, what tends to happen is that this notion of a tributary system becomes kind of totalizing. It becomes a way to explain East Asian interstate relations. It becomes a way to sort of explain even the thoughts of individuals in such a way as to sort of erase human agency. And so, you know, I find that on a theoretical level, it's kind of a hot potato. It's a little dangerous, I think, because of that kind of totalizing tendency. But, I mean, it's a good question, because actually people who argue for the existence of the tributary system actually make that point.
With that, I think we can thank our speaker. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.